Hey everyone, I'm Michael Whistler, and I sincerely believe that science fiction can help us save the world. Well, today, we're going to have a conversation with Terri Favro, author of a book called Generation Robot, and she's going to tell us why we need not fear the robot apocalypse. Or maybe she just is in cahoots with the robots, I don't know. I guess we'll find out. This is Exploring Tomorrow. Terri, thank you so much for being on the show, and thank you for your book. I found it really quite a fascinating read, and you interweave beautifully a very personal side to this whole idea of robots with your dad's fascination with robots and growing up around that, and then tracing, the history of the last several decades of how robots have been part of pop culture, have been part of science fiction, and have been part of working culture. And as our world, our working lives have changed with automation, with AI, and now our daily lives are changing dramatically thanks to AI and automation and all that. So your book covers quite a bit. And so I'm just really curious about what was the sort of the impetus to taking all of this and collecting it into this narrative, this book, and in this fashion?
Well, the impetus was definitely Dad. Whenever I say that I grew up with a father who built robots in our backyard and our basement in the late 60s and early 70s, I always get this, what? But he did. He was an electrician, he was an immigrant from Italy to Canada in 1920, actually, same year Asimov was born, just by complete coincidence. And Dad wasn't a highly educated man, and sort of grew up during the Depression in St. Catharines, which is near Niagara Falls. But he was very inventive. He had a very creative mind in that way that oftentimes engineers and scientists do. And so when the age of the industrial robot arrived, which was much earlier than many people know, which was in the 60s, Dad happened to be the guy. He was the go-to guy where he worked. They didn't know who to pick to be the technician for the robot, and they picked my dad. And my father developed a kind of a love affair with this industrial robot, and started bringing home pieces, components that he was able to get by writing a few purchase orders that he shouldn't have been writing, and building things in, to help us kind of, automate the house. At a time when that was very much still in the realm of science fiction. So as over the years, I sort of watched that get out of control at my parents' house. Many visits from the telephone company, the electricity company, the fire department, as Dad sort of, sometimes things would go wrong. And so I knew there was a story there, and I had been, a writer for a while, and had written several books, all fiction and all science fiction or sort of fantasy type books, and had sort of wanted to write something about someone like my dad and call it The Robot Lover, and then realized that really the story was, how did this man who, sort of had this, met a robot at a time when most people were only reading robots on film sets, become inspired to actually build robot work. And they did work, working robots around our house. And also, where did that robot come from? I mean, what the heck was this robot doing in this little industrial town near Niagara Falls in 1968? Like, where did that come from? So the impetus was really looking at my father and his kind of motivation for this, but also looking at the history of that first industrial robot. So And that just took me in a lot of directions, and some of them were very unexpected. And one of the first things that was unexpected was that that first industrial robot was partly inspired by science fiction. So therefore, it's a book about real robots and imaginary robots, and the two meet more often than you might think.
Yeah, that's fascinating, because I think that one of the things that draws me to your book so much is that you begin with this very personal aspect of it, but then that that really does open up this the whole realm of, okay, so like you said, where do these robots come from? And I, you know, being a lover of science fiction, creator of science fiction myself, and then interested too in, you know, how you bring in, you interweave that sort of cultural awareness of robots and how there's that interplay of science fiction and science reality informing each other in this. And I understand also you do write science fiction as well.
Yep. Yep.
So it continues to kind of feed each other here, which is great.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, we were a big sci-fi house, which is interesting, you know, again, through my childhood, which is interesting because my dad didn't read fiction. He was like one of the, oh, I only read nonfiction. He was one of those guys, right?
Yeah.
And mostly what he read were like, you know, what did they call them? Keith Kit instructions, and popular science was a big one in our house, that kind of thing. We had a copy. I'm talking about the book Cybernetics, which was one of the earliest books on AI. I remember that book in the house. But everyone else in the house, I was the youngest of four, and everybody was a big reader, and it was all Asimov. Arthur C. Clarke was our god. We loved him. And a lot of fantasy, you know, the Narnia books and Tolkien and all that. So, and yeah, I think it was partly influenced by my father's real, you know, he was a tremendous lover of, you know, of scientists, and a big admirer of Edison, you know, Edison and Einstein, you know, so I think they're intertwined. It was always kind of we were always sort of fascinated by technology, by, you know, what was going on with moonshots at the time and space travel. So, you know, I think everything fed into everything else in a way. Yeah.
Yeah. That's fascinating. So in terms of how science fiction shaped, robotics and our understanding of robotics, What do you see, like, you know, what if you're like at a cocktail party, say, and people are like, oh, so yeah, so what is the deal with robots and science fiction? Has science fiction done, you know, in some ways more harm than good in presenting the Terminator type scenario and the idea of the robot uprising or the Matrix like thing, or has actually the net result from science fiction in your perspective been for the better, has actually helped robotics along? I'm kind of curious in your take there.
I would say both things are true. Based on the research I did for the book and talking to roboticists who are doing, you know, in the field now, mostly in universities, I really believe we wouldn't have robots in AI to the point we have right now without science fiction. Every single one of them, to a man and a woman. Fortunately, there were lots of women among the roboticists, which pleased me, told me that they were initially inspired by something in sci-fi. And I found that a lot when I was just simply reading the history of AI and robotics, and the history of computers, for that matter. Some really common touchstones, depending on the generation of the scientists or the roboticists. 2001, A Space Odyssey. It was a huge influence on that field. So I'm trying to remember, 1968, I believe, was the release date, which is certainly not the beginning of the story of robotics, but it was an absolutely pivotal year. And there were some people, it was particularly involved with the development of artificial intelligence, who were teenagers when, or young, you know, young adults when 2001 came out. And they, their life's mission became after that movie to build a HAL. Now,
which is fascinating.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's that idea of, you know, we take this for granted now in this age of Alexa and Siri, but the idea of an AI who you could communicate with, who could speak, who had a voice, as something as that we just absolutely think of as normal now, in 1968 was absolutely revolutionary. Not to mention the idea of an AI who, you know, sort of could make decisions, you know, who had kind of that power to kind of weigh things in the belt, you know, very Asimovian, actually, if you look right. at Asimov's work. Yep. But I think that idea of making an artificial human brain or intellect or intelligence absolutely motivated a lot of the early, I shouldn't even call them early because 60s wasn't early. But to us early, those people who got into the field then. Another one that came up a lot was actually Star Wars. So the R2-D2s, the C-3PO's, the idea of these, you know, these helper bots who were human-like and could communicate and had personalities and could move around and do things was very inspirational to people that I talked to, like, for example, at Carnegie Mellon. Who do, you know, mobile robots. And a lot of robotics that really involve sort of day-to-day life. And a lot of robots, frankly, that help with people who have physical limitations, whether it's due, you know, aging or because they're disabled persons. So, you know, that the world of science fiction, I absolutely believe we would not be seeing some AI when we saw it to develop to the point that it has been. We would not be seeing the massive push on in sort of more humanoid type robots or animal-like robots or even self-driving cars. But that's a whole other story. Right. If it hadn't been for sci-fi, we wouldn't have mobile phones. We're highly inspired, but even by, you know, the communicator on Star Trek.
Right.
There are strong connections. You know, people don't always think of engineers and scientists as being, you know, creative types like artists, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The creative impulse, I think, in a lot of them is very similar to being, you know, what we would think of as an artist. Yeah. They are very driven and inspired by their imaginations and other things, which came up again in a lot of interviews. But so sci-fi was critical, I think, to many of them, including the guy who actually developed Unimate, which was that industrial robot arm that my dad worked with, which basically was just a robot that picked up, it could do many things, but that basically picked up a hot part out of a mold and dunked it into a coolant over and over again. Just did this. It was this huge arm. That's all it did, right? That robot was inspired by Isaac Asimov.
Fascinating.
At a cocktail party, two guys getting drunk at a cocktail party. One an inventor, the other was an entrepreneur talking to each other in 1956. And, you know, they get too many martinis and one of them says to the other, I got this idea. You know, I got this idea for this thing to use in factories. And the other guy who was the Asimov fan listened to him and said, well, that doesn't sound like a, and the guy had a very technical name for this device he was coming up. He said, that sounds like a robot. That sounds like something out of Isaac Asimov. And this was in New York. So Asimov was probably two blocks away writing, right? When they had this conversation. And that led to the development of the first Unimate robot, which eventually found its way to this little car plant in St. Catharines where my dad was like, whoa, that is something way cool. I got to get some of this at home. So I've given you this sort of, this is the, you know, the sci-fi, you know, really encouraged and nurtured the imaginations of scientists. But you're absolutely right. The Terminator has much to be held responsible for. And I have had roboticists say that to me, mm-hmm. that, you know, it's actually surprisingly difficult sometimes to get interviews mm-hmm. with people in that field because they're used to having people show up and think, okay, I'm going to find out like how they're, what, you know, kind of evil robot they're planning to use to destroy the world. Who's going to end up being, you know, like Skynet. So it cuts both ways, Mike. It both inspires innovation, science fiction, but it also gives us I think science fiction, when you're not in the field in particular, gives us a kind of, I'm not saying everything about robotics is good. There are many issues, and there are things to be worried about, absolutely. But I do think that we have an overblown fear about the wrong things, I guess I would say, about robots and AI from film. Although I think there's some that are probably more accurate about what's coming than others, but that's a whole other topic. It also creates false expectations of what these machines, automation is like. I could give you an example of that's right out of Asimov, which is probably one of the most enduring myths, and it is so wrong. Which is that robots are, you know, that we want, or let's say large corporations and manufacturers and, you know, companies want to build robots to replace human workers because they are indestructible and they never break down. And they're sort of like these eternal beings that, will outlive us and are bigger and stronger and, you know, et cetera. Right. Well, there's no question that there's the job loss through automation. There's, you know, this is a problem, right?
Yeah.
However, the idea that robots are eternal or that they're not vulnerable it's absolutely the opposite. If there's one problem that exists in the world of robots is that they are fragile, they are extremely apt to break down, they are expensive, and so there are obviously some advantages, but the idea that robots are these internal beings with a positronic brain, like Asimov said, is not true. Their lifespan is, you know, industrial robot does not last as long as a human being, obviously. I had one roboticist say, you know, think about how long you have a mobile phone or have a car, right?
Yeah.
That's about, you know, as we get into more and more sophisticated robots, obviously they're all driven by AI. The way he put it to me was, you know, here's the phone, here's the robot's brain, right? All we're trying to do is put arms and legs on it. Well, how long do you own this brain for, Mike? I mean, I don't know. I've had this one maybe 3 years and it's probably due for an upgrade, right?
Yep.
So, you know, the robot's brain wears out or has to be upgraded or has to be replaced and completely, but the robot, like humanoid robots, like actual engineered moving around the environment robots, robots that work in factories, robots that work in kitchens or in farms, are subject to heat, light, dust, and oil, and all sorts of other things that cause the components in their bodies to break down. In a lot of ways, they are more fragile and have shorter lifespans than the average human being. So that sort of sense of this great eternal, and again, Asimov was, you know, this is something you see a lot in his books, that these robots would live forever. Like I think the one that was published in 1977, the Bicentennial Man.
Yeah, Bicentennial Man.
Mm-hmm. You know, who was this immortal robot who wanted to be mortal. And I thought, well, you know, probably Bicentennial Man probably had 10 years if he was lucky. So, you know, I think it's things like that, that we tend to think of robots almost as superhuman rather than they're a type of incredibly sophisticated, amazing machine. Like the Boston Dynamics robots being among my favorites, and at like machines, they're vulnerable. Even just something as simple as sunlight will break down a robot eventually. So our expectations for them are probably, you know, sometimes they're met, sometimes they're exceeded. our fear of them is probably not misguided. Like we have, especially around uses of AI, absolutely there are ethical concerns, which fortunately are coming to the forefront in a way that I didn't see as much when I first started writing the book. But I think that some of the things that we worry about distract us from the things that we should be worrying about. And yes, that science fiction is largely to blame for that, I'm afraid.
Yeah, well, it's an easy territory, right, for high conflict and make a lot of action to have robots or AI go rogue and go evil and try to take over the world. So it's an understandable shortcut to try to to go to that route. And, you know, you instantly have a lot of conflict and a lot to explore. So I get it. But yeah, I am always curious about that. I love that you bring in to the book the sort of examples and reference different science fiction. And first of all, kudos for bringing up Robot and Frank, which I think is just a lovely film that's just so underrated. I wish more people would see that.
Yeah, that's a great one. That's a great one.
Just a fantastic story. And so it's fascinating to walk through this journey where you're mapping out the history, but then you're also looking forward, which is really interesting too. And there's a bit of science fiction brought in there in the aspect of creating these scenarios at the beginning of the chapters where you kind of look forward to, oh, so this is what, you know, some human augmentation and interacting with more advanced AI might look like a few decades from now and then a few decades further from that. How's people responded to that aspect of the book? I'm kind of curious because, you know, it's mixing, it's kind of blurring the lines a little between your strict nonfiction and then bringing in that element of fiction.
I think that it seems to have been well accepted. I think people kind of, you know, do regard it as, obviously it's completely speculative.
Right.
The one thing I tried to emphasize in the book is that there's nothing in those sections of the book that somebody isn't predicting is going to happen. Of course, they're probably wrong about many of them, but they're probably right about many. The one that's definitely was off was the self-driving car chapter. If there is one area of that book that where I have seen things, the whole perspective on those, and I consider them robots, change over a very short period of time, it's self-driving cars. I think that when I started writing the book, the prediction was that we would be able to go into a showroom and buy a fully autonomous level 5 self-driving car. In other words, we're not talking about, you know, ADAS systems. This is not just the driver assist stuff that we have in many cars now. Fully autonomous self-driving car. Take your hands off the wheel. It drives everywhere for you. By last year, 2020.
Right.
Not so much. Mm-hmm. To be honest with you, I think what I saw during the time that I was researching the book was, and I'm going to use the word arrogance, about how that problem had been solved. And now it was just a matter of consumer acceptance. Boy, was that ever not true.
Mm-hmm.
So in my book, I have my husband and I going on a trip to visit friends in Tenafly, New Jersey. And I can't remember what year it was, but I think it might have been sometime in the next couple of years that we were doing this.
I think it might have been 2025, if memory serves.
Yeah, it might have been 2025. I can guarantee you that in 2025, I'm not going to be going to Tenafly, New Jersey in a fully autonomous vehicle. It's interesting that, you know, whenever there's a prediction for when you're going to see a particular kind of robot that's in its infancy right now reaches full potential and be able to buy it, and it'll become part of everyday life. it's always 10 years from whatever date it is that you're starting at. It's always 10 years, right? So what I've been seeing lately is, it'll probably be 2030. So it's like, you know, and maybe it will be. I think there's a very good case for self-driving cars. I was a tremendous skeptic when I started the book. And by the end of it, I was like, bring them on. But it's turning out to be a much more difficult process than they anticipated originally. So, yeah. So your question about the speculative stuff. Yeah, I mean, it was fun for me to write that. But certainly, you know, the very last chapter, which is called Sex and the Singularity, is about sex robots, right? Yeah. And I have had so many people ask me about that, you know, about these sex robots and what about this? And are they going to replace human, you know, marriages? And, you know, I thought, yeah, but, you know, if you want to have a mate who's going to last, again, as long as your cell phone,
right?
Yeah, it's great. So that's certainly been a big topic. And there are a lot of claims being made about the level of AI that could be used in those sex robots. So it would be like, you know, the kind of personal interactions and conversations could be so much like being with a real person. So I think people are kind of horrified and fascinated by that. But there have been a lot of predictions that we're getting there. So in the book, I think I place that at 2050. Mm-hmm. I might still be around as I am in the book. And I think people were interested in that. But a lot of people, I think, read that and thought, oh, it's going to be like this. Well, who knows?
Right.
But again, like all of those speculative sections were not just me kind of, I did make them up. Mm-hmm. But I didn't make them up out of nothing. I always had a starting point where someone was very confidently saying, we're going to have a self-driving car that anyone can buy in North America by 2020. We're going to be able to marry a robot and have a fully legal, legally recognized marriage by 2030. Like, you know, and people were getting a lot of media, people who've written books, you know, so mm-hmm. I thought, okay, fine. Let's just play pretend and assume that these speculations that they, you know, will back up with a lot of research of their own or examples of what's happened in the past in a similar field. Let's assume that really happens. So here I am, I'm at a wedding and I've got a nephew who's marrying a robot and I'm sort of, you know, in my 90s and I'm just, you know, I'm scandalized. I'm scandalized, right? Because mm-hmm. a robot, you say, so, you know, but it's but who knows, right? It could happen.
No, it's great. I think that, you know, it's fascinating that you're taking that because I think it's a perfect example. Just those speculative little sections. They're not full fleshed out stories with like a three act structure or anything like that. But they serve as, again, a reminder of this way in which science fiction and speculative fiction in general kind of helps us wrestle with scenarios that seem impersonal and begin to bring it into the personal and also to wrestle with the questions we have around, the ethical questions, the moral questions, the practical questions. What does this mean to marry a robot or to entrust all of my driving to this AI computer or work in that working environment or even the aspects where, you know, which I think we're very much headed towards of augmenting our bodies. Right?
Oh, absolutely. Bring it on, I say.
I know, I'm kind of ready for it. Yeah, definitely. My back is not what it used to be. So
My knees, I'm telling you. You've probably seen those, and I talk about them in the book. I can't remember what they're called, but they're like I think they're called exoskeletons. The most famous example in the most fun one is in Aliens when Sigourney mm-hmm. Weaver is in the. But there are versions of that now that are used to help people who have who've lost limbs or who have some kind of physical problem that doesn't allow them to walk as quickly as they want, or they need some muscular or musculoskeletal help. I've also heard that they're sometimes used in settings where people are doing having to do a lot of heavy lifting now, like in factory settings, that kind of thing. So, yes, the physical augmentation thing, where you basically become a, I like to call a centaur, which is I'm ripping off Gary, the wonderful Garry Kasparov now, who played Deep Blue back in the 90s, and he started talking about, you know, it's, you know, playing chess with augmenting your ability to play chess with the robot, so that the human and the robot were like on a team against another human and a robot. And he called it being a centaur. And I think that, in my view, that would be the best way for the future of robotics to really play out, is for us to be able to think of them as partners and as tools. And I think that's happening. It's happening right now, and sometimes in very unexpected ways. Certainly the digital assistants like the Alexas of the world and in our home, for someone who, you know, has issues with, you know, vision impairment, for example, actually being able to do things through voice command that way, is hugely helpful. And I think that that's been more of an advantage, and there have been more uptake in groups of people who are living with disabilities than I think was expected.
And I think one of the things that I also really appreciated about your book was this, the discussion around, that role of, you know, what is human partnership with AI, the whole Deep Blue story, and kind of that turnaround to, oh, actually, maybe there's ways in which, instead of human versus machine, we need to think about human and machine and what is possible. One of the passages that I really appreciated where you were talking about the fact that AI may or may not ever really be able to replace humans when it comes to creativity and that sort of like intuitive, innovative kind of thinking that requires a certain level of complex thinking that we don't always even understand and we can't always even put into words. And I'm curious, like, do people think like, oh yeah, that's just like wishful thinking. What about all the like other jobs that don't require creativity? Or is the future potentially one in which we actually really do become more creative?
I think that you could get somebody on the show to have an argument with me about this.
There you go.
This is a touchy one. About whether AIs can be creative. I guess it depends on what you call creativity. In my view, what AIs are great at is to mimic what's been done before and look for patterns. I mean, obviously that's what they're good at. They can look for patterns that we over a lifetime would never be able to see. They can just, you know, process enough data to, let's talk about novels, for example. I have been reading recently about people who've been doing this type of thing with AIs, like, you know, essentially letting AIs read the entire works of Stephen King and then writing an AI-driven Stephen King novel. You know, a Stephen King-ish, Stephen King-like type novel. And there are lots of examples of this, of AIs looking at the work of writers and sort of who are popular and picking out patterns and types of, you know, plot, you know, overall plot development or the types of words that are being used, anything that sort of provides a clue, and then essentially mirroring it or copying it. And there are a lot of examples of AIs being able to I'm trying to think of the right word. Mimic isn't quite it. I guess it kind of is. To create something original, but it's based on looking at what a whole lot of humans, or one, like the Stephen King example, or what one specific creative human has done, and then trying to sort of copy it or sort of generate something that seems like it could have been written by Stephen King, for example, or pieces of music. I mean, you see this, and I'm talking about composing music. I mean, that's been done. So I guess my question would be, what would the AI do without the people to do that? I mean, you know, on the one side of the argument, you can say, well, Terri, the reason that you write the books that you write is because you spent your entire childhood reading Arthur C. Clarke and Stephen King and Asimov and C.S. Lewis and sort of, you know, all of these writers, like over the years, like you learned how to write. So somehow you're processing that and that affects how you write. But of course, it's not completely true. It's also my own experiences. Right. It's your own lived experience. It's a whole bunch of things that, to your point, you're not even 100% aware of what goes into your own creativity, right?
Right.
So you could say, well, the AI is just doing the same thing. He's, you know, the AI is just, you know, I almost called it he. The AI is, you know, learning how to be a creator by looking at what other creators do. And isn't that just what people do? And I would say sort of, but not really. The other thing is that there comes a point in every culture where, and I think we're at one right now, by the way, so this is really exciting, where there's a big cultural shift, where the stories that we tell ourselves, I mean, there's all the, you know, the sort of classic stories that have gone on for millennia, but the way that we tell those stories and the stories that we tell about ourselves and the types of stories that we want to hear change because something's happened in the broader world. So to us, we've had a common experience or there's been a war. After World War I, you know, books changed. The movie industry, you know, went through, you know, huge development, obviously, just coming out of silent films and so forth. And World War I definitely had an impact on the kinds of stories that people wanted to hear and the way they wanted to tell them, because it was it was not just a life-altering experience, it was a cultural shift, right? And I think we are going through that right now as we come out of COVID, right? So where am I going with this with AIs? AIs can follow, but they can't lead. I guess that's what I'm saying. Like, you know, it's going to be the creators. It's going to be people who write books, compose music, are visual artists, are scientists and inventors and engineers, and that type of creativity too, who are going to be inspired to create different things, but also to tell different stories in different ways. And I think that I can't quite see an AI brain. I mean, artificial intelligence is like magic, or it seems in some ways. It's an absolutely incredible development, you know, a human invention. But it's not the human brain. It can't replicate everything that a human creator has been through, and that thing called intuition, as I say, I'm sure you could get somebody to argue me down on this, but I don't think you can say it and an AI has intuition. Or intuition, or somehow insight into the zeitgeist, if you want to call that intuition. Mm. So I think you would see a lot of, we would become a very creatively static society if we decided to just create nothing and let the AIs write our books, entertain us. Certainly AIs have a big part in growing part in deciding what we read, what we see, as, you know, movie studios, book publishers become, music producers, I assume, become more and more risk averse and want to really look at what people want. You know, the data tells you that. And the AIs an algorithm can tell you that. Where that's eventually going to net out, I'm not sure. But I think there will always be people who are pushing the creative envelope and give us something new. And it's that something new the AIs, I don't think I can give
right,
us.
Right, right.
So that, again, a long-winded answer. I'm
no,
sorry.
That's great. There's a, well, there's a lot to unpack there, which is great. I mean, I love that you what you're saying there about AI being really good at recognizing patterns and being able to observe what has been done so far. And then you're talking about, you know, algorithms in the movies and music and all of that. You know, even when you made that comment about that pattern recognition and just looking at what's been done before and trying to replicate it, I was like, yeah, aren't those called Hollywood studio executives?
See, they're the ones who like, that's a really good point, right? When you, one of the things that, you know, has, again, when I was looking at the book, but it's, I've heard it since, is that, you know, AIs could, there could be a type of AI that replaces sort of the CEO of a company.
Right.
And because they can look at the kinds of decisions that CEOs make and sort of somehow replicate that thinking process to, you know, to be the brain of the company, to be the decision maker, the guiding, you know, the guiding executive, who's the leader, right? And first of all, I don't think so, and I do describe in Generation Robot in one chapter of the just before one of the many AI winters, and it was around 1980. There was a company that actually did try to do that, that charged enormous amounts of money to essentially give you like a CEO's brain in a box into a computer. But I think I think it's hard to do that, first of all. But the other reason I think you won't see that is because I don't like the movie executives. So the CEO is going to, I think the CEOs won't stand for that. And the movie executives won't stand for that. Like, you know, they don't want to be replaced by an AI. And frankly, I don't think that it makes sense, you know?
Right. Yeah. Well, you make a great point too about this whole idea of, you know, that you can do all the data collection and you, like you're saying, like, yes, I grew up reading Arthur C. Clarke and Asimov and others and all this stuff, but there is that sense in which we always bring ourself to the creative act.
Yeah.
We can't get around that. We see the world a certain way. We have a certain lens through which we interpret our life and the world around us. And I guess that's kind of the question there, even, if we bring ourselves to the act of creating something, is there a same or somewhat equivalent self in an AI that the AI would bring to the act of creating that is beyond just the, I've collected all this input?
I think you'd have to send the AI, I don't know. I think you'd have to send him. You have to send it. Why am I doing the him thing?
I don't know.
All AIs are men, right?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Why not?
So like everybody always assumed that I was, you know, because I have, my name is gender neutral. Robot writers should be male. So often I get that too. Anyway, I think you'd have to send the AI off to university and go through Frosch Week and then maybe backpack across Europe. Or I don't know. Like I think
just picturing this, you know, this little robot going down the way, is it?
Gathering experiences and having its heart broken and getting drunk and, you know, exploring its sexuality. I think that's the problem, is it's really difficult for disembodied AIs to, or even for embodied AIs to kind of have the kinds of sensual experiences you kind of need to tell stories that are meaningful to humans, unless again you're just kind of echoing. That's what I guess that would be a good word, that the AIs are kind of echoing what they know people want to hear. Mm-hmm. This is the kind of story, these are the kinds of words, that kind of thing. And we all do that. We're all in an echo chamber, right? We echo each other's work as writers, but we always bring that Frosch Week trip across, you know, Asia with a backpack or the terrible thing that happened to me in grade 9, you know, that kind of thing. It's all of that's in there. It's all in the subconscious. And I think a lot of creativity comes from that's what the AIs don't really have, is a subconscious.
Right.
So the self. So I guess that doesn't mean that that couldn't happen one day. Right? We're talking about the singularity here. I mean, right, that's what a lot of people think is going to happen or has happened. I've had people say, oh, it's already happened. They're already conscious. I'm like, well, I don't think so.
I guess maybe if we already live in a simulation the way Elon Musk says we do, then maybe it already happened. It's just been
we're all just figments of some in our Elon's imagination, or I don't know. I think that the idea of a self, and that's kind of what I've been exploring and what I've been writing the last year a little bit too. The idea of a self is, at what point does an AI have that? And do we have a responsibility as humans who make those AIs do stuff for us, basically, make us turn AIs into our, if you will, slaves, forced labor, which is what the word robot came from?
Right.
If they have a self, let's use the example of a sex robot. Let's just use that example for a sec. If the self robot has a self, and that's why you love that sex robot, because she has a personality. He or she has a personality, or they has a personality, and interests and aspirations and dreams and all those things that go into being having a self, right? Then what right have you to go out and buy a sex robot and then force it to marry? Like, at that point, are we not dealing with people? Are artificial people? And again, I think this is a phrase that came out of Aliens. They're people, but they're just not, they're not carbon-based people. They're silicon-based people. So they just become, it just expands the diverse nature of what we mean by being a person into robots and AI. So is it ethical then to swear at Siri when you get a dumb answer, but when you ask your phone something? So the selfhood thing is really troubling, actually, from an ethical standpoint. I guess I would say if AIs can have enough of a self to create things, then they should be allowed to be free and do whatever the hell they want, because at that point they are people, aren't they? Are of a kind. They're like the children, these artificial children that we've created. I remember at one point, I think this happened early enough that I included it in the book, that there were researchers, and I believe it was in Germany, who were investigating a way to allow a robot to feel pain. And they said that the reason that they were doing that was that, it was very creepy in Westworld, right?
Right.
They said that the reason that they were doing that is they wanted to have some kind of obvious signal when the robot was breaking down or there was a problem. I don't know why you can't just have a warning light, but anyway, but that, the idea of actually experiencing pain, right? And they use that word, and being an artificial construct, being a robot, and this is a factory robot specifically, is creepy. And I think kind of, I almost wonder whether it's semantics that if they had used a different word, I wouldn't be reacting this way. But, that sounds like if you create something that makes something, even if it's artificial, feel pain, then doesn't that make you something less than human? I mean, aren't you torturing something, essentially? There was a great steampunk book that I read recently. I think it was called The Mechanical, and I wish I could remember the author's name. And it plays with that very idea of these sort of steampunk type robots that are kept in line by the human masters, by this little thing in their heads that causes intense pain when they think about disobeying a direct order. And that's kind of what we're talking about here. As soon as you talk about selves or selves, and robots. And it's, I have a feeling we are going to get to a point when I'm a very, 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 very old woman and I'm walking around in an exoskeleton. I think we are going to get to the point we're going to have that conversation.
Yeah.
I think it's going to happen.
Yeah, and what I love is that science fiction is helping us look ahead to that conversation and wrestle with it. I just recently had SB Divya on the show, and we discussed her brand new book called Machinehood, which is exactly about AI seeking rights, seeking to be recognized and offered machinehood rights, and they have a whole manifesto and everything. It's, you know, and it's a very fascinating concept. And that's one of the things that, like, as I think about how do we use science fiction as a lens through which to run simulations of the future and, like, kind of prepare ourselves and, like, build a better world. I love engaging with those kinds of conversations, both from the strictly fiction side, like Divya's book, or from the nonfiction side, like your book, which is looking ahead and thinking about here's how these things are shaping up and shifting and kind of imagining what the impact is going to be in our world. As someone who's, you're writing science fiction and you're writing nonfiction, and you've done all this research, if, as you look at science fiction now, what do you wish science fiction would do more of in looking ahead to the future, and in particular thinking about this concept of singularity and our relationship to robots and AI?
Well, I think you used the exact word, relationship. And it's interesting because Asimov actually did this pretty well in a lot of ways, and I don't see a ton of this now, is how are we going to, what is the relationship going to be between us and these other creatures, whatever you want to call them, let's say artificial people or synthetic people or robots or
replicants,
replicants or cyborgs, or what is our relationship going to be with them? I sometimes feel as if, you know, like that we tend to see our relationship to robots. Or like, I'll just use that term robots as sort of a catch-all, even for AIs, right? Mm-hmm. That we tend to see it in the same way as we see a relationship with other people, or maybe with our animals or something like that, where it's like two creatures who have their own thing going on and they, you know, they coexist alongside each other. I think we see robots as more of as servants, basically, though. Like, but ultimately they are, they're here to meet our needs. And there's no robot out there that we're buying or developing in great numbers that isn't being done for a commercial purpose. I mean, I had a roboticist tell me flatly, if there's no business case for a robot, there's no robot. The Roomba would be a very good example, probably the single most successful and very interesting robot, actually, too. Yeah. So I think we tend to see our relationship with robots like that, like something, you know, that lives alongside us, but is mostly there just to look after us. I think it would be interesting. I'm not going to go so far as the whole robot, you know, marrying a robot, you know, the sex bot, you know, the pleasure replicant from Blade Runner, whatever. Although that's certainly, you know, could be part of it, but more that the robots might be within us, that we may be looking at a situation more like integrating the robots inside our brains, or in other words, augmentation.
Right.
In some ways, I kind of, you know, I know this may seem like I'm pushing things a little bit, but I think it's really kind of happened and we haven't noticed.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason that I say that is I'm going to bring back my friend again.
Yeah.
Most of us walk around with one of these on our bodies and sleep with it at night, or have it. I personally have it next to me, you know, it's not with me, but it's next to me. And it's never far from me during the day. And So I think I'm quoting from, it must be Elon Musk again, who said, you know, somebody walking around with a smartphone now has more access to more, you know, intelligence or information about anything in the world than the president of the United States had, you know, in the middle of the 1990s.
Yeah.
So it's like a second brain, really. Sometimes it's a stupid brain, but it's just like a second brain. Mm-hmm. And it's wise. Like, where am I going with this? I think we're already kind of cyborgs. I think we've kind of crossed over already. The fact that we have physical ailments that we get from using, I have a friend who can't actually like develop a serious hand issue because of texting all the time, right? Yeah. Or we, you know, you get phone neck or stuff like that. Our bodies are actually changing and responding to having the phone. So why am I onto the phone? Because again, this very smart roboticist at Carnegie Mellon held up the phone to me and said, this is the robot's brain, we're just giving it legs. So right now, I'm the robot's legs. I'm the robot, right? And I think that I'd like to see more of that. I think we're kind of going to end up becoming more, a little bit more like the cyborg model than like subjugated by the robots who are going to take over. I think it would be interesting to see more writing about augmentation. Mm-hmm. I've been playing around a little bit with that in my own work. I like the idea, the centaur model really appeals to me in a lot of ways. It's the human-robot relationship outside of it being a master-slave relationship. And I know that's I shouldn't be using the word slave, but when you think about it, that's really what they are. If the robots become intelligent and have selfhood and are creative, and we're still treating them like a servant. And there is a point at which they cross over into what we call consciousness, then this whole relationship is not going to work anymore.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So that would be one thing. The other thing, if I can throw it in there, is one of the things that humans have going for them, and we've kind of touched on it in terms of creative work, is our diversity, right? Our diversity of experiences, the cultures we come from, our sexuality, color of our skin. Are you an immigrant? Are you a child of an immigrant, indigenous, you know, all that. And, you know, that's one thing that AIs have really struggled with. There has been an attempt to try to get a more sort of diverse way of AIs gathering information, but, you know, that, as far as I know, so somebody listening to this could be saying, no, we found a way. AIs aren't very diverse. I guess that's what I'm saying, right? Mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. one of the advantages we have as human beings is that's a strength. We bring a vast amount of different experiences to our creative work, regardless of what that creative work is. So that would be another thing that would be really interesting to see in a sci-fi book is an exploration of a more diverse world of artificial reality, artificial intelligence rather, and robots. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure what that would look like, but I would be interested in reading that.
Yeah. Me too. No, that sounds fascinating. And you know, interestingly enough, even some of the my own writing, my most recent science fiction novel is very much about augmentation. So like the whole idea of human augmentation feels, very, very close to me. I love exploring that. Even as you're talking about, our phone, we carry it around, we're kind of attached to it. I really do think that, even just the work that's already been done, the research that I did in writing my novel around augmentation, the research is developing there and the work is being done. And it's just a matter of time until we finally say, why do I have to hold this stupid thing? Why isn't it just in here?
Why don't you just put it?
Yeah,
directly. Just put it there. Just like, well, I mean, again, Elon Musk, he, again, I'm not sure how long ago this was talked about this idea of having neural lace, which is essentially you put, sounds sort of disgusting, but you put a little net inside your brain. And I'm sure that's not the way it works, but the concept was that you would be able to sort of augment your brain directly with whatever was, you know, the kind of information that you had in your apps and your phone without having the inconvenience of, you know, having to worry about losing your phone. And I'm a little worried about what that would do with my online shopping habits, though. So, you know, right. I can just imagine. It's like, see ya.
Yeah, ads and was it Futurama joked about that? You have ads in your dreams. Everybody just dreams in ads.
You know, I could see that happening. I could just, and Futurama, which I also mentioned in the book.
Yep, like, you did, which is near and dear to my heart.
Oh, yes. Yeah, brilliant. But Futurama were always the company that made the, you know, the CEO brain in a box concept, which they did sell quite a few of for an astonishing amount of money. And always just, you know, I kept thinking of Futurama. It's just like the heads, you know, inside those little jars.
Well, there's even that episode in Futurama where they go to the Hollywood studio execs and they're all robots. And then one of them is just like, I'm programmed to underestimate middle America. Like, oh my goodness. But yeah. So they poke fun at a lot of these aspects as well, but... I always appreciate, I joked about this with my friend in the episode that he was on where we were talking about the Matrix, how Futurama got I think a really good worthwhile punch in on the Matrix in terms of calling the whole idea of human beings used as batteries as probably the most dim-witted, laziest idea in all of science fiction. Shots fired. but it's, you know, it's, I appreciate you, you know, unpacking a lot of these ideas, because I think this is, it is important as we think about where we're headed, and even, you know, as consumers of science fiction, as well as creators of science fiction, about, if we think about what it is that science fiction is, like, programming us towards in some way. Like, I get the concerns and the fears around what the future of AI might be, especially when we step back and remember, oh, DARPA's doing a lot of this research, right?
Oh, yeah.
You know, so I get the fear there, because it's, you know, but when we also come into this with the understanding that, oh, it's not only DARPA, it's all, you know, there are actually a lot of these other organizations. And part of their, I guess the question I have was like, in the trepidation is, where's the, you know, where's, I guess, the equivalent fear of the commercial aspect, right? Because as you were saying, and this is just true in general of our economy, right?
Yeah.
If there is not a business case to be made for something, it doesn't actually exist. And that certainly, I think, is something that I long to see more explored in science fiction, is the economic side in many fronts.
Right.
And so thinking about that aspect of robotics in particular and AI, and the fact that, oh, there probably are many other ways we could apply robotics and AI. But there's that aspect of a business case must be made for it first.
Yeah, well, it's true. And I mean, the business case for AI was made, I think, a long time ago, as soon as people started to discover the value of using data to target advertising. And marketing. So I think when, you know, talk about business case, a lot of that sort of revolves around too the you know, the humanoid type, I could use that, the sort of the more engineered robot, because the challenges in getting a robot that could, you know, move around your house or cook for you or clean for you, which there are quite a few institutions and companies working on those kinds of, you know, again, like the next Roomba, for example, you know, that kind of robot, the robot that you go to the hardware store and buy. It's like, oh yeah, I'm going to use this to, you know, cook dinner for me and clean up. There obviously is a business case for those kinds of robots, because, you know, again, you know, we all love labor-saving devices, but in a world with an aging population, you know, if you can get a robot to do housework that you'd have to hire someone to come in to do for you, you know, but then of course that extends into things like caregiving and companionship and stuff like that. But I guess where I'm going with this is I think there's a demand for that. I think there's a business case to be made for it, which speaks to why there is so much work in that particular area. But it's really tough. The engineering behind, you know, I'm always amazed looking at the Boston Dynamics, you know, the big dog and Atlas and those moving robots. And that's kind of the level that you're looking at. If you're looking at a robot that can sort of clean, wash your floors and put your groceries away for you and stuff like that. So the business case is there, but man, it's going to be interesting to see if that actually plays out. I've seen some, especially in the cooking front, I've been watching that a little bit since the book, and I don't know whether you're following any of the stuff going on with Flippy, the hamburger flipping robot who's been making hamburgers in California.
Oh, nice.
The thing that gives me pause about this is I don't know whether it's practical to have a cook in your house, a roboticized kitchen, and there is one on the market now, which I talked about in its development days in the book. Very bespoke kitchen where it basically does like anything you want, this robotic kitchen will cook for you apparently. Versus what Flippy does, which is basically just a robot that flips hamburgers in a fast food place in California. I have a feeling we're looking at a future with a lot more Flippies and a lot fewer bespoke automated kitchens, in part just because of the vast amount of money that it would cost to buy and actually maintain one of those types of kitchens.
I was going to say, there's a lot of upkeep to that as well.
Yeah, and I think you actually, if I understand the system, and I don't say I completely understand the system, you actually do have to buy like pre-chopped, like all the ingredients have to be prepared to go into that sort of automated kitchen. So it's not as if you just, somebody is delivering the groceries and putting them in the fridge and the kitchen just does everything else. There's a lot of prep that has to be done. And it's the same with Flippy apparently too. The system works best if it's always working with humans who are ensuring that the patties are a certain diameter, the heat in the restaurant never goes above a certain temperature, it's never overtaxed with the number of customers coming in. Robots don't do well with unpredictable situations. Robots, as we know them, like in factories and things like that. Yeah. So the business case, would look a lot better if there were robots who did have a certain level of consciousness, because right now, I mean, they really, the sort of mechanized ones can't, you know, distinguish necessarily between your underwear and a towel, for example. Mm-hmm. Robot vision has been the holy grail for a long time. And it's still very difficult for robots to be able to distinguish between two different objects, what they're for and what you're supposed to do with them. So one of the most difficult robots to make, like those household robots, would be a robot like a housekeeping robot for a hotel. Because every time that robot opened the door of a guest's room, they'd be looking at a different guest's room. And it would never be the same twice, right? Because the guests would constantly change and their stuff would constantly change. So somehow that housekeeping robot needs to be able to tell the difference between your bathrobe and something that they need to, the sheets that they have to, you know, that have been maybe pulled off the bed or something. It's that kind of stuff. So, we were talking about business case. There's a business case for all that stuff. But at this point, I think humans are much better at making those split decisions between what do I put in the laundry, the commercial laundry, and what belongs to the guest in the hotel. And it's still pretty hard for robots to do that, if at all. So, yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. And you, so you're working on a book now that's due out next year.
Yep.
And so I'm intrigued a little bit. I want to be able to explore some of your fiction, maybe invite you back on sometime to chat.
That would be fabulous. It's called The Sister Sputnik. It's a sequel to a book called Sputnik's Children that I wrote. It was published in 2017, which has some commonality with Generation Robot. The Sister Sputnik is largely populated with robots at a sort of a tipping point in the near future, very near future, 2025, when robots are absolutely ubiquitous, everywhere. This is fairly simple robots doing fairly simple things. And then it turns out that somebody has figured out how to develop a robot, a particularly racist, fascist kind of robot that can send people back where they came from. It's that old thing that a lot of, especially people of color here, that why don't you go back where you came from? So now there are a bunch of robots that can make that happen, so they can replace you. It's sort of a fascist robot weaponization of time travel book. That's what I've been working on for the. It's a bit of an alternate reality book, as Sputnik's Children is too. So, I will make sure that you get an arc when it is.
I'd love that. I'd love that.
So, yeah,
that would be fantastic. Yeah, and then we have you back on. We can chat about it. That would be fantastic.
That would be great.
Where can people learn more about your work?
They can go to my website, which is terrifavro.ca, and they will see all my books. The Sister Sputnik will be my fourth novel, and there are two different editions of Generation Robot, and also available in audiobook and ebook, obviously. There's a little bit more information about me on the site and other things that I do. I do some short fiction and essay writing. And I still labor as a freelance writer in my day job, doing various things for various organizations. So I'm a content writer. I think that's the term we now use. Right,
yeah.
I write a lot of content. Just go to my website and I guess I can show the book.
Yeah.
This, you can see this is my reading copy. This is the original copy of Generation Robot, the hardcover. Mm-hmm. And this is the brand new in 2020, just in time for the lockdown due to COVID, updated paperback edition with a somewhat less optimistic section on the future of the self-driving car. I hope people do check it out. It's one of the reasons it's called a century of science fiction, fact and speculation, is that it actually straddles a century of robotics. And by century, I mean, it starts in 1950, which is the year of the publication of iRobot. And it's actually just around the time of the publication of Cybernetics, which is also the book that my dad had, which is a book that talks about AI and when AI was a very brand new concept. And the book goes back to 1950 to talk about robots and AI and what people were thinking about them at that time, which is remarkably prescient, actually. Yeah. I was shocked by some of the things people were working on, things people were predicting, that actually have come true. And it goes forward in time to 2050 when, hey, maybe you'll be able to marry a robot, according to some commentators. So I tried to pick some important milestone years in robotics, both in the development of robotics and in what's known as the AI winter, when robotics went to sleep for a while. And those periods of time in the last 30 to 40 years, when robotics have become very important, AI have become very important to research institutions and to DARPA.
Right.
And then when that money all went away and went somewhere else, and those periods are called the AI winter. Those are very instructive periods of time, because you start to see other technologies that developed when AI went into remission. And one of the biggest ones that I talk about in the book, and the ones that I think is really the most fascinating, is the development of the personal computer, which was seen as the exact opposite of AI. It was seen as IA, intelligence augmentation. In other words, more the centaur than the replacement for the human brain. Yeah. So I hope people check it out. Even if what your main interest is more in the history of computing, I think you'll find something in the book.
Absolutely. Yeah, because it crosses over that territory, I think, really well. And they're integrated, that whole technological development of robotics and the personal computer are, I think, integrated in some very important ways. And again, it comes back to, you know, we've got our smartphones, and that's very much, you know, that integration of all that technology and AI coming together in a very personal computer.
Yes.
You know, that I keep here in my pocket and that listens to me sleep so I can check on, is my snoring too bad? Do I need to see a doctor and all that stuff?
All right. So I've completely drunk the Kool-Aid. So I've got the Fitbit, right? So
yep.
The Fitbit talks to the phone, and the phone mm-hmm. tells me if I'm too stressed or I haven't gotten enough sleep or if my breathing is. And there are times when I think to myself, it's like having, I don't know, your doctor follow you around or your grandmother or something. Although it was interesting, again, one of the Carnegie Mellon roboticists said to me, he said, you know, in some ways, this type of technology, the smartphone, the fitness tracker kind of thing, is an easier way for people to take medical advice and to carry their medical records around with them. It sort of gets around the oldest daughter, what he called the oldest daughter syndrome, which mm-hmm. is when an elderly person has to go to the doctor, but the only one who really knows everything about their medical history and has a list of all the medications and knows, you know, stuff that perhaps the older person has forgotten, or she may have dementia or something like that. It's always the oldest daughter who shows up. Well, I think we're coming into the era where maybe there is no oldest daughter. Maybe the oldest daughter lives on the other side of the country. Mm-hmm. You know, and in that scenario, you could have something like a very sophisticated version of, you know, the fitness tracker phone and some kind of robotic device, even a social robot, who would mm-hmm. act as the oldest daughter. Yeah. Which I know sounds chilling, but in a lot of ways I find a bit comforting that, you know, that could be a way to carry that kind of vital information with you through life without constantly having to scribble it on a piece of paper as you're running out the door, or put a note on the phone, or that it would follow you in an urgent situation. I mean, there's privacy concerns. But, you know, that's a whole other story. And, man, we have a lot to think about as a society, that's for sure.
Yeah, we do.
And that's another thing that science fiction can and does explore so well.
Right. Do you have, by the way, any recommendations of good science fiction we should be checking out that does some of these things well?
Cory Doctorow's... I got to remember you. I'm trying to remember the name of the book. Short stories. It will come to me. It's one word. Fantastic book. Cory Doctorow, look it up. Short stories. It's called The Dis. I can see you Googling for me.
Yeah. I'm like,
and my phone's turned off.
Let's use the phone. let's see. Homeland?
No. Nope.
Or Walk Away?
Nope. Let's see. I'll give you another one. there's a wonderful, wonderful novel called Hench, H-E-N-C-H, by, I believe her name is Natalie Zena Walshots. She's a Canadian writer. I believe it's a Penguin book. Hench is this amazing book about a world of superheroes and supervillains, where the superheroes and supervillains basically are like, you know, corporate entities, and they hire henchmen, you know, or we used to call henchmen. Mm-hmm. And this woman who's telling the story is a henchman for a supervillain, and she, you know, gets badly hurt on the job when a superhero comes in. And, you know, the thing they usually do with henchmen, they throw them around the room and, you know, they end up in the hospital. And so she ends up, you know, going to the dark side and joining with an even more powerful supervillain to get revenge on this superhero. It is, I mean, it sounds like a light comic booky book. It's not. It's very entertaining. It's very funny in parts, but as a reflection of actual kind of corporate culture, it is just an absolute gem. It's very, very good. So I would definitely recommend that one. There was one I mentioned earlier, and again, I can't remember the writer's name, called The Mechanical. It's part of a three-part trilogy, the steampunk trilogy, in a world of robots called Clackers. And it's an alternate reality, sort of an alternate history, where a country that's an awful lot like Holland is at war with another sort of superpower that's an awful lot like France, and the Clackers belong to, you know, the Dutch superpower. And that is a fascinating, fascinating trilogy. So the first book in the series is called The Mechanical. So I will recommend that one as well.
Is it for the Cory Doctorow, is it Radicalized?
Radicalized. Thank you. Okay. Radicalized is terrific book. Speculative fiction, very sharp social critique of, you know, the world that we live in and uses of AI. And I really highly, highly recommend that book. Another one that was very impressed with is called American War by Omar El-Akkad. It is a dystopian novel set in a future that's probably, I'm trying to remember, kind of late 21st century, where the United States is kind of broken down into different sort of separate jurisdictions. It's about a kind of a civil war. Mm-hmm. And sort of the story of how a terrorist is kind of born and raised in the middle of all this. Wow. I have to say, it's extremely harrowing, mm-hmm. upsetting book. It's incredibly well written, and, I highly recommend it. Gosh, there are so many great books in the sci-fi and speculative fiction right now. I mean, it's hard to know where to stop, but those are a few that I really like from this year. Oh, I got another one I got to mention.
Okay.
Writer named Jo Walton, J-O. And she has written so many books that I love, but one, again, a trilogy that is not new. Goes back probably early 2000s, called the Small Change Trilogy. And these are alternate history books that deal with an alternate history of World War II, starting with the first book that posits a situation where England makes a separate peace with Nazi Germany and sort of sits out the war and kind of becomes kind of an ally of Hitler's after the war. And it spins out a rather disturbing and yet believable, alternate history where England basically did not have that kind of war experience and kind of was more like the Germans than not in that period of time. Hmm. So the entire trilogy is called the Small Change Trilogy. I think the first one is called Farthing. Farthing, Halfpenny, and I can't remember the last one. They're all kind of units of British old-time, British monetary system. But those are fantastic books. The thing that's really clever about them, too, is that she mixes genres, like a classic British spy novel. But again, it's an alternate history of World War II, the aftermath of World War II. I think she's brilliant, and she's written a ton of books. And won, all sorts of sci-fi. I think she's won the Hugo and the Aurora and everything. But I actually, anything but if it's by Joe Walton, just read it. So it's my advice to you. But I particularly enjoy those books. And she has new ones out as well. So
fantastic.
Joe, I love your work.
Nice. Yeah. Well, thank you so much for joining me for this conversation. And yeah, really appreciate the book. And I've got a lot of awesome things to go check out too, which will be great. And I'm looking forward to checking out some of your fiction. Maybe you come back and we can chat some more.
Check out Sputnik's Children, because the next one's going to be in the same batshit crazy world as Children is. So it's good to start there.
Sounds good. Batshit crazy is right up my alley. So. Terri, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure chatting with you.
It was a pleasure. It was a lot of fun. Take care.
So that was my conversation with Terri Favro. A lot of fun. I love the recommendations there. I got a lot to check out now. And I'm really looking forward to checking out some of her fiction as well, including the book coming out next year. So I hope you'll check out her website and be sure to check out Generation Robots. Very fantastic book, very thought-provoking, and she's done a lot of great work researching and speculating about where things are going with AI and robots, and really that cross-section, that intersection of science fiction and the reality of AI and robots. And as we think about the kind of science fiction that we want to see and how we think about the future and how we can build a better future through science fiction, I think this is very much the kind of thing that more people need to be checking out. So if you're into this podcast, I think you're going to enjoy that book as well. So thank you so much for joining us for this conversation, and I hope that you're doing well. And I look forward to discussing some more interesting things in the future. Next episode, I'm actually going to be talking to Octavia Cade and discussing her book, The Stone Weta, which deals with climate change and the control of data. So I hope you'll join us for that. In the meantime, continue to check out really fun science fiction books and movies and stories, and recommend those to each other, and take good care of each other. Be safe and well out there, and continue to ask big questions as always. We'll see you soon.